all of us love. And we thank you for your many blessings. Please help our council to make responsible decisions as we work to make Dahlonega a better community. And please be with our mayor as he guides us through these difficult times to move us forward in this process. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I actually have a Dawson.
do know that the citizens of this community elected 7 people up there to protect, defend what Dahlonega is, stands for, to defend the businesses in this town. And we all know that the businesses in this town depend upon a lot of other people who don't live here coming here with their money and spending it here. And yet now you've been swayed, bullied, in some manner to think that this Holiday Inn, whatever the hotel, motel looks like, is going to attract people. People do not come to a town for a motel. They come for the buildings, the ambiance, the restaurants, what we stand for. And as our mayor said, oh, I guess about 2 or 3 meetings ago, they were talking about some of the things that that woman wants to do in this town. And he made a comment, and I'll paraphrase, that's just not part of the line. And neither is that thing that y'all are going to vote on today. And the rumors are true. We're in a couple of years going to have that thing.
And yet, Ellen, brick monstrosity that we've seen developed by Roberta Green Garrett's architecture being built, destroying the Bavarian businesses right in the middle of downtown Helena, building something like that. That would be the same thing. Well, look what it would do to the city of Helena. But this is even more serious because this is our history. It's our heritage. This is what we're all about, and we're destroying that. I know about the fact that the buildings are in bad shape, and there probably needs to be something to replace them or at least use some of the facets of the architecture of the Parks building to rebuild another structure there. But this right here, no. That's not what this town needs. It's not what people need. It's not what the people who come here to Dahlonega to tour this town, to stay here and see what we got. This is not what they want. It's not what we want. And it should not be what you want. Thank you so much for letting me talk.
Thank you.
Anybody else wish to speak?
restore the plan. Thank you.
I'll let Kevin identify his first and second based on voting.
The first text amendment is to add in definitions community center and those districts that will be added into is going to be CBD, B3, R1, R2, R3, and PUD. And conference convention center and districts will be CBD, B3, B2, and PUD. And cultural facility, which will be CBD, B3, B1, PUD. And then event center will be the same as well as dental hall. People recommend approval. If you have any questions, please let me know those.
Okay. Planning commission recommendations on these?
They recommend approval.
Okay. Is there anyone in the audience wishing to speak on these amendments? Anyone? Okay. Mr. Mayor, we could vote now if you wish.
Okay. Is there a motion to approve this? Are we voting on one or
one and two?
We're voting on one at this time.
Okay. Motion to approve public hearing for case REZN 04-18-04.
Okay. Got a motion on the floor?
Second.
A second on the floor. And just for the benefit of the public, what this really is, it's housekeeping. We need to clean up some of our zoning and definitions. We have businesses that want to operate that we simply don't have definitions and classifications for as in our ordinances today. As we grow and we become more complicated little community, we need more definitions, and this is one of them. So we've got a motion and we've got a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Item number two.
Item number two is to alter the planned unit development contiguous acres from 3 to 2. This will allow for any planning unit development that requests to be rezoned to come in and only have to have 2 contiguous acres. That's the only thing that's changed within that requirement.
And the planning commission?
Planning commission, you recommend approval.
Okay. Anyone in the audience wishing to speak on these changes? This change. We'll turn to the public and state your name and address, please.
Okay, ma'am. I can hear your name. Cynthia Gilbert, 205 Rainy Creek. I'm wondering why they feel the need to decrease the size of the zoning. Why is that a necessary thing?
Well, the gentleman to your right can come in your left, so to your left.
Sure. There hasn't planning and development for some of the areas that are closer to the downtown could be used if it was a smaller acreage. We haven't seen any type of development there. Okay. I'll use a much deeper voice. How about that? So when we took a look at all the planned unit developments that were inside the city limits, there were a lot of them for much larger acreage for housing developments, but we didn't see anything for anything commercial or multi-use. So we're trying to lower the amount of contiguous acres for that so that we can spur some development that would be for multi-use. So it would be either shops on the bottom, residential on top, kind of things like that. That's why we're going to a smaller acreage. Westing, to get a smaller acreage. Does that answer?
Anyone else wishing to speak on this matter?
So, yeah, I'm sorry I didn't catch the relevance of your response. Is there a particular developer or party that is interested in moving in if this passes? And number two, when this was originally set out as having these larger parcels, there was a reason for that. The reason for that was that we don't want... earlier we saw a picture up here
So it's its own district. So if you request to have it rezoned to HUD, then you could ask for the requirements that are inside of Plan B development. It's to allow and to help spur some growth of different areas. We haven't had somebody come to us and ask us to do this. We haven't had a development that has came to us. We have just taken a look at the larger economic outlay and try to figure out a way to spur some development in parcels that aren't moving, that aren't being built on.
This, I should point out, this is also an alternative to doing what other jurisdictions do, creating a whole bunch of zoning districts that are seldom confused. It's not uncommon to find jurisdictions that have 18, 20, 25 zoning districts, and it just increases the burden of trying to administer them. The flexibility of PUD allows the council at the time of approval to require a wide range of conditions in conjunction with the approval of the project.
Does that answer your question?
Apparently,
they're unable to do that now with the 3 acres.
They can do that on 3 acres, but
that's not a good thing.
The challenge in Dahlonega is the topography and the parcel size to begin with. This would only affect roughly how many parcels less than 100.
It has to have 100 feet of minimum lot width of 100 feet, so it has to, you know, have 100 feet of lot width. And then two contiguous, it'd be two contiguous acres instead of three.
So the people that would be helped by this are the property owners, because now they can sell their property for this use?
Correct. That's one of the problems that approval.
Is that what this is?
No, this
is this is just to change the text to allow for somebody to petition to have a property that is 2 acres or great, 2 acres, at least two contiguous acres, to be rezoned to Plan B development. It's not a rezoning, it's just a text amendment to allow for them to come and petition for that rezoning.
They can request.
Then it's up to the council to approve it.
Someone could petition the council to move their property into this type of zoning, and they would have to meet standards for that. It's not a blanket kind of a process. Okay.
I understand. It's a real estate thing. I would like to know who owns the 100 parcels that you're talking about. Who is going to benefit from the change? That would be interesting.
We wouldn't have that information.
It's not that many parcels. There's maybe about 56 parcels within the city limits that could get to this.
So have any of those people approached you to ask you to change this?
They have not. This is a staff recommendation.
Okay, so you're just making up stuff to do? Do you have a study to show that this is a good thing for this community to do? Do you have some information that is better than just, well, we know.
We examined other PUD districts in other mountain communities and found two was happening. Sustainable in other places, and seemed appropriate here because there was a variety. Several of the parcels, let's just say, in whatever it thinks of the line in the downtown area, those squares of entire city blocks, some of them are only one neighborhood size. So you could not use a PUD district in the downtown area for the most part because the parcels are too small. So this is really not intended for the downtown area. This is for other properties that, because of topographic constraints, have not been able to.
And not 100, but 56 pieces of property exactly are in question, right? Those are the ones. Okay.
Yes, we're holding it in the GIS.
We're talking about doing this for 56 properties. I just would like to know who you're doing it for. Whose properties are they? Why? How is it
implemented? We didn't even consider that.
Yeah.
So we don't have that information.
We're not looking for the individuals that it's going to be helping. We're looking at the town, see how we're doing the town.
All right. Anyone else wishing to speak on the subject that hasn't spoken? This is available for a vote.
Can I ask a question? I was an applicant, so I just want to ask a question. Ellen Morocco is from the Westminster. Can I just want to make sure I understand this. We're not talking about changing the city limit.
No.
So, we're not talking about annexation. What we're talking about is those parcels that are within that city limit that may want to someday maybe change their zone.
Possible.
Right.
Okay. So, thanks.
All right. It's ready for vote, Mr. Mayor. Okay. Is there a staff recommendation? This is close to staff recommendation.
Staff recommends approval.
Yeah. All right. Close reaction to the council.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to approve public hearing for case REZN04-18-0002.
Is there a second?
Second.
A motion and a second. Further discussion?
Just clarification for everybody, just so they know. So we have this already, and it's 3 acres is the minimum that can be done. So the Bellamy, are y'all familiar with the Bellamy property? That's across from Foothills Grill, the apartments. Okay, that's a planned unit development, but it sits on more than 3 acres. So if there was some type of developer that came to town and said, I want to do some type of mixed-use development, and I have this parcel of land that's less than 3, we can't help them. So this will help us to help them. Hopefully that clears it up. If there wasn't, we don't have any, but as Bill, as the city manager recommended, this is a recommended because of our topography, and it's similar to what other mountain towns do.
Is there a way to get a list of the 56 people that own those properties?
Ma'am, you can submit an open records request, okay. and they can provide it.
Appreciate that, sir.
Very good. Motion and second. Any further discussion? Did you have something, Mr. Chairman?
No.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Mr. Mayor, we have one more public hearing. Cofield Pruitt Properties Partners is seeking to rezone from B1 to R3 with conditions. Mr. Davis, are you representing Cofield?
Mr. Mayor, before Jason starts, because I'm an adjacent property owner to this property owner, accused.
Councilman Gaddis chose to recuse himself from this action simply because he's an adjacent property owner and just the air and abundance of caution and don't know what appearance of anything. He's requested to recuse himself from this vote, from this action. Mr. Davis, you have the floor, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Council. appreciate what you are doing, and I don't think anyone here in these clear positions tonight. Any other way? So the item for you is actually a rezoning of 2.97 acres, which would have been on the MTV rezoning process had it been here. So this is an example of one that was on 56 list of only here in the world. So you have a copy of this plan in your packet, I assume, letting multifamily units on the 3 acres. Had a graded site that was previously graded by a former owner, and developers would come in and build these units immediately. So I'm here for any questions you might have. I believe we've submitted everything that you require. If you have a recommendation plan, you may also have more happy to answer questions.
He's not applying for the PUD, man.
He just said that he wouldn't put any good because of that rule. Did I get that wrong?
He just said he was one of the 56 that would be benefiting from the new agreement he made with it.
But he's not applying for PUD. He's changing zone.
Let me rephrase.
Okay.
We would have submitted for a PUD if it were allowed. We are 3/100ths of an acre short of 3 acres. So in this situation, we're being forced into an open zoning of R3, which is what we're asking you guys to approve tonight. It will not be allowed, and I apologize for you bringing that up. So,
suspicion runs deep. I'm glad you're here.
I'm not the owner. I don't know.
Yeah, this property is one of the 56 properties. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Jason. Yes. Kevin, could you go ahead and provide the staff and plan for the
Sure, just so I can, I agree with the condition. So we're requesting to add the condition, and the condition states that it is a reduction of the 25-foot, reduction of the front setback from 35 feet to 25 feet, just reducing it by 10 feet, and that's to be able to allow them to position on the pad away from the R1 zoning district that is close to them, because there has to be a 50-foot buffer between the development and the boundary. Planning Commission recommended approval as well as staff.
Very good. Thank you. Anyone in the audience wishing to speak specific to this application? Anyone wishing to speak specific to this application? All right, that concludes the public hearing.
Very good. And we'll take action on this as well.
Yeah. Very good. And may I suggest one thing? What we'll do is next month you will receive in your packet suggested ordinances adopting this matter.
Very good. Okay. Council's heard the recommendation and the information. What is the action of council?
I move that we approve case REZN 0418003, proposed change in zoning from B1 to R3 with conditions.
Very good. Have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Very good. Thank you, Kevin. And that will conclude our public hearing. At this time, we have an appeal for the historic preservation decision on the 29th. Do you have that here?
Yes, we'll do this.
I'm personally myself, and I was not there, but I take responsibility, not necessarily for general public. Lots of times I don't. I've actually been there working on, also an artist, and I work light painting, and sometimes I do stay over in that unit for safety and security of my inventory. But I was up late painting one night, and two young men decided to try and steal the age of Santa from Gaby Antiques. I stepped out the door and stopped them, and I did not call the police. I did a little gateway because I wanted to be the lady who stopped the death of Santa. She didn't want to have nothing. But anyway, that was a year or two ago. I feel that the design and look of the fence is satisfactory. This is a 1950s historic building. It's not an 1800s. It is a 1950s brick building. And at that time, pine lines of this sort, which I had my jasmine now climbing on the fence, the roof fencing behind the middle fencing. And I think that the historic commission needs to take in mind when they do consider these applications that the our corner, where the young man spoke about his business at the carriage house, we're 1950s, we're not 1800s. I think that should be considered in the decisions when they allow these new design colors. The white metal fencing I put out matches the black handrails that I installed for safety on both my doors. The reed privacy fencing will become a wonderful display of jasmine vines with seasonal yellow flowers. This is not bamboo, it is reed fencing which will support the vines better than lattice. Plants I have added are jasmine, cherokee fences, dogwoods, two dogwoods. Lavender, daffodils, Asiatic lilies, speedwell, fuchsia, garden phlox, hibiscus, and these plants need time to mature. My neighbor Gateway Antiques came in and added an arbor to complete the look. When a fence is added 4 to 6 feet off the rear wall, this still allows the area for use by Gateway to use and decorate as a sitting area, whatever they choose. Please take note that Park Place Hotel has a current application for fencing pending for their corridor, as they call it, I believe, as a patio. The Catholic Church building has the same metal fencing in front of their building. The George Butler residence has metal fencing in front of his building. Old Storehouse Inn and Gustavo is all currently in fencing. And Antique Shop on the corner of Metterson's Lane also has just had a new fencing added for safety. And my safety concerns are noted by that's basically my appeal. My understanding is that they allow the metal fencing and not sure about the reed fencing. I feel that's better than lattice work. I also feel it's better. I would prefer to have flowering yellow jasmine there than I would evergreens to block the privacy. I do my best to water the city's flowers on the corners, and I will kudos to the city for putting flowers on the concrete curbing that the team installed in my shop. So the whole place was all concrete before, and now it's beautiful flowers and a corridor. Please consider my
thank you. Thank you. Mr. Mayor, this was basically a judicial matter in the sense, and the council's this is not a public hearing. The council will be looking at this to determine whether there is an abuse of discretion. An abuse of discretion.
An
abuse of discretion on the part of the HPC.
Okay.
Mr. Harry, did you wish to represent the HPC?
I do. I wanted to clarify 2 points. Park Place Hotel does not have an application for fencing. They have an application for renovation of the patio, which is going to cost kind of before HPC. The section that calls out the historic guidelines is section 3.2.6. Privacy fences are not appropriate in front yards. That is the section
you see COAs from that at any time?
For the benefit of the public and the council, a piece of the property we're talking about is the corner of Grove Street and Main, and which is across the street from this restaurant. There's a partition of fence or privacy area, a made out of reed with wrought iron up against it, or cement wire. That's the area that we deliberate on now. Any other questions?
The applicant can get, did the applicant have the opportunity to get with HBC to ask what would be appropriate under our ordinance?
She did not make it to the meeting.
May I present that I was working as a real estate broker that night, and I had a contract come in, an offer on a piece of property I had completed and was unable to make it to the meeting.
My question is, if HBC denied it, how did it get installed? Or why did it get installed?
It was already up. And so we
so it got installed before a COA was
correct
applied.
It's my understanding that the only remedy is did HBC, the Historic Preservation Group, did they abuse their authority or not? That is the question, of course. That is the question that I would need a motion on. Did the Historic Preservation Commission abuse their power in making this judgment, or did they not? And that is what's before the council at this time.
Mr. Mayor.
1 second, please. Ms. Oliver.
My apology. I just wanted to make a suggestion that there is an appeal process set in place for the HOC. Historic Commission, I'm sorry.
Correct.
Because I didn't have an appeal process. I had to come directly to the city council after denial. And they did not make any suggestions for any other options.
Any other questions, comments, discussion from the council?
I'll make a motion that I don't believe HBC abused their discretion of power in this case, so I'd like to make a motion that we uphold the HBC ruling.
And that's denied the appeal. And the appeal will be denied.
The appeal is denied.
I'll second that motion.
A motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
So, is there a remedy for Ms. Oliver to revisit this?
Yes, you can refile. There is, and we've talked about refiling and possibly coming up with a different idea that would meet the guidelines.
Okay. Well, for the sake of civility, I wish y'all could find some common ground, try to work together if you can. And accommodate if possible. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. I appreciate your efforts.
Thank you. Okay, very good. Appeal denied. Under new business, we have our chamber director here, and he's welcome to chime in if he would like to. Under new business, the Dahlonega Plateau, the ADA designation of the region of North Georgia, encompassing a lot of Lumpkin County and Black County and other counties, but primarily with North Lumpkin County, 133 square miles, I understand, is now officially, or will soon be officially designated as the Dahlonega Plateau. And it will have a similar significance as the wine claimed to be from Napa Valley. As he bottles of wine, leave our little community and go all over the world. Have a designation of the Dahlonega Plateau. This is a very good deal. This is great. This is really good for us in the community and the wine industry in particular. And I know that the chamber has worked diligently on this, trying to get federal recognition and federal agreement. Do you have anything you'd like to add, Rob, on that huge accolade?
No, Mayor, just thanks to President Amy Booker, the predecessor of the chamber, that laid a lot of groundwork for this, and there was a lot of work from all of you all to pressure the federal government to actually do something right. So thank you all for your efforts, too.
Well, we felt like speaking with one of the owners of the winery that it was probably appropriate to have a party. Hence, the party on the plateau. We don't know if that's going to actually materialize or not, but if it does, all the public is really stay tuned. We may have a party on the plateau. Old business at this time. First item of the old business is consent order of Ms. Roberta Grigier. And this consent order was placed before us. There was a motion in our last action on this item to present it to the opposing council. Opposing council made no or minor changes to it and is back before this council for action. At this time, if there's any discussion, I'll entertain it to the best of my ability. And the question at this time is to accept this consent order and move forward to the Superior Court for them to enforce and write this consent order. And that's what's before you at this time. Mr. City Attorney, did I miss any significant announcement on that?
No, that's exactly the issue.
It was tabled at the last meeting. Did we have to make a motion to move, bring it off the table? Or is this?
It was continued to this meeting.
Continued to this meeting.
Okay. Continued on to the call. Okay. So I don't think it requires a motion.
Okay. So that is what's before you. And before we get into discussion, if there is discussion, we would entertain a motion. What is the reaction of council on this item?
Right, Mr. Mayor, at this time I'd like to make a motion that we accept the consent order from Roberta Grigier with the stipulations that you would be negotiating on the hotel design.
Okay. So that's the motion. Is there a second?
I didn't hear it with the stipulation that, sorry.
That the mayor would negotiate the hotel design. Work on that.
Represent us.
Okay. Motion on the floor. Second.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. It is right for discussion at this point. Councilman Hall.
As I mentioned before, I have four hotel application, but I don't agree with the seller, specifically a large franchise motel or hotel at that location. We have a small historic district off the square. I don't have a problem with the franchise hotel, but that's why I'm not agreeing with the consent order.
Very good. Councilman Gaddis.
How did you know I had comments?
I saw your posture.
Similar to Councilman Hoffman, I'm also in favor of a hotel in this location, but I think the size and scope is a little too large for that area and that footprint. Specifically violates, I think, the commercial construction guidelines and the HPC guidelines 5.1.4, which indicates that the building should be no larger than 75% of the lot. So I think, we have guidelines and we should follow them.
Are part of the zoning ordinance. of changing that. We just have to change those three sections in the zoning ordinance and go through proper procedure for it.
Mayor, I'll make a motion to accept the staff's recommendation to revise the wording of the ordinance.
Good motion. Second. For the public, what we're trying to do is try to modify our ordinances so that if there is a business that is applicable for outside dining or meet our ADA requirements, that they would be able to serve alcohol in that same area. Motion is second. Any other discussion?
Mr. Mayor, at this time, we had discussed this, that we would allow it for this weekend since it is the holiday weekend. We have a motion to approve. If you'd be willing to make your motion to allow it 90 days.
Is there a 90-day wait?
There could be seven motions.
Oh, okay.
We can vote on this, but is there an opportunity that we can offer a temporary allowance of this on this motion by this ordinance to be amended?
Yeah, when this first came up, I made one recommendation quite a while ago that you might want to do a demo period or a 90-day demo period. And then that period would expire, and then at the end of that, we would have fleshed out the issues, whatever the issues might be, and then you could craft your final amendments and so forth to your regulations to be consistent with what you've experienced during that demonstration period. And that was a recommendation I made quite a while ago that it might be appropriate to consider that.
You would be able
to. Yeah, Mr. Mayor, we have revised the motion on this item to approve the wording of the ordinance effective immediately, subject to a 90-day demo period that the ordinance change would be evaluated to quickly we come back in 90 days to clarify the wording and finalize this action.
Very good. And the second was, who made that second? Very good. Motion is second. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Very good. Status modified the 2016 alcohol ordinance that will accompany and the legalese to allow us to also allow
it. What we did is to mesh with the work that Mr. Harris has been doing, we did a modification to the alcohol rate, and which basically refers to the alcohol regulations will be satisfied if the requirements mentioned by Mr. Eric are satisfied. In other words, the ADA standards, all those things, the optional issue of fence or no fence, or whatever you wish to do, so long as those are satisfied, the alcohol rates will be satisfied. We adjusted those provisions in the alcohol rates to allow this.
Very good.
And that was disclosing the fact.
We'll entertain a motion to modify these alcohol ordinance as well.
Motion to approve the modification of alcohol ordinance.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Mayor, we don't have a designation as to the number on this. It's 2018 something.
Okay.
So we'll have to find that. Okay.
Very good. Mr. DDA Director, Jim Harrison, do you have an update on our Hancock Park kids' play area?
The memo in your packet is address that. It is an ADA compliant surface, and all of the various parts of the playground are accessible in some way, fashion, or form to those of all abilities. It's, for instance, the double cloud nine swing is one that multiple children may go in, and so perhaps a child that does not have the ability or upability can still be participating in swinging with other children. So it gives communal play activity and also can help those who perhaps cannot do certain things to still experience the joy of swinging.
Excuse me, Ms. Harris.
Yes.
Mary, is it possible to scroll down on what you have on the screen and show the photos of the that were included in our attachment that we received?
No, they didn't know they did. Okay. Yes.
There you go.
Thank you.
So who helps there?
Can you get back on the
thing? Oh, thank you.
So what you're looking at down in the bottom left corner, those are the Cloud Nine swings. That's something that, as I was mentioning, will allow lots of children to play on it. You also have the different interactive animals, that is a trout and also a bear cub, which does kind of echo what we have in our area, the trout and our streams and the bear cubs we have in downtown. There's also something that's not shown in there because it is unique. There's only one other in the country, and that is a mine sculpture that would allow children to play on, under, and around. That the only other one is in Colorado. And so this one would be the only one not only in on this side of the Mississippi, but in the southeast. Definitely in Georgia, the southeast, and it would be totally unique to us. It would be almost constructed here, and there's not another that would get into it. As far as the other items in there, we do have sort of a nod to the age and seeing the arts. The center portion of the playground has various musical instruments. They make sounds that are more natural. It's not going to be clanging. It's going to be the sound of wood, the sound of wind chimes. So it will be children can make music and get those people who are in the park to not be experiencing clanging, which is good. Let's see, what else would I need to tell you? This would, it does not intentionally duplicate any of the playground features found in our area parks. That would be like City Park, Eagle Creek Park, or other people's school playgrounds. For instance, the one that's behind our offices here. It's going to be funded, we're proposing that it would be funded by contributions from local civic organizations and also by the hotel and motel tax proceeds designated for tourism product development. But as I mentioned, this can be a tourism destination. We have families, we look at downtown, families come with children, and this will give them something to do that will make them want to come. Because, as I say, this is not your average player. This is going to be something completely unique to the lodge.
Very good. Okay. The question for the council at this point is, you have the bid in your package, and if you're ready to proceed, and I think DDA is ready to move forward with this.
Well, to incorporate discussion, I'd like to make a motion that we accept staff's recommendation for the development of the playground in Hancock Park for the quote of $194,434.62 to be funded as reflected by Ms. Harris in the presentation.
Motion and a second.
Any further discussion? I'm really excited to see how this has changed in terms of what we originally looked at as a playground in that. And for those for the benefit of the public, it's in the north
northeast corner of Hancock Park. So that would be kind of that area over there behind Diamondville, that area that's not really used during concerts and things like that. So it'll be in that area. When we first looked at that, it was your typical playground that you see in every schoolyard, and you know, had climb things and swings and all that. And this has now become very unique, and there will not be another one like this. This will be the first one in the state of Georgia, unless somebody builds one like it before we do. And there's very few of these playgrounds like this in the country, so I'm excited that we're going to actually do something for the people and for the kids of this community and for the kids that visit our community.
Can I add something to that?
Please,
The tourism product development money that we're talking about to fund this is supposed to be, the state tells us it's supposed to be used for anything that's a potential attraction for Dahlonega. That is how the money needs to be used. And I feel that a playground like this will certainly get people's attention. It talks about it actually shows children about our history, and I think that's very important. And I think it has what we call the wow factor. People are going to look at it and say, wow, what a playground. It's going to be better and different from anyone else's, but those are things that will bring additional tourists to our town rather than tourists who happen to be already in our town and say, well, we'll use the playground, but this will actually be an attraction. So I'm really excited about it.
Yes, I am. I echo what everybody else said about the appeal of this playground, but I did not notice in the package anything addressing a fence. And I think that's very important for safety of the children that are playing on that corner, which is quite close to two streets.
This was just the design from Ida Sculpture. So what we have been looking at is a right angle, as Councilman Gaddis mentioned, it is on that corner, and we're looking at a type of fence that would resemble a picket fence. If you go down the post at the Diamondville, so again, echo that. And so that would be something that we would be putting there. It is definitely in the plans, just not in the
bid. It's not in the bid, though. So it would be an extra expense. It would be an extra expense beyond the.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, there was a proposal from a playground manufacturer that includes basically a design build option for the playground. We want to be consistent with Public Works construction law and other purchasing guidelines. So I'd ask that if your intent tonight is to make a motion to project, to really be authorizing staff instead to work towards that. We have to confirm that this would be sole source equipment related to vehicle. We have to confirm that first. And there is room in the budget from what you guys gave us at the original meeting to include the fencing, some landscaping, some benches, some other pieces of equipment that you're not showing in the front plan. So we would like to
to know about turn lane.
Oh, so everyone is one set of ways ready for the turn lane, you know, 155.
For the benefit of the public and the council, this is a project that was mainly brought forward by Councilman Hall. On Winterville Road, as it runs into Grove Street, it's nearly impossible to get out of there if anyone has turned left. It was his idea that maybe we should pursue a right turn lane to free up that traffic. And that's what we have here before you all at this time. And our funding was short, our estimates were low, but it's very beneficial to have a senator that lives in the community. He was able to help us hopefully obtain some additional funds to the tune of about $50,000. And I feel like I can say that it's a good asset. We have secured those additional funds. So what action do you need before the council?
I just recommend a war to Rains Grady on.
Did that have your low bid?
Yes, we had, I think, 110, 116, and 140 after the bid.
I'll make a motion to approve this, Mayor.
Got a motion, is there a second? Got a motion, is there a second? Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Good, thank you. Steve Marshall, do you have any discussion for us?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Harris, do you have any further discussion for us?
No, sir.
Dan, do you have anything else with the DDA?
No, sir.
And Ms. Melvin, other finances?
I'm good, so we got it all.
We sat and I discussed this morning the meetings for the council to review the budget for fiscal year 19, and we're looking at holding those meetings July 17th, 18th, and 19th. Send out the detailed information on those, but kind of keep that in mind. Then the city manager would actually present the complete budget on July 25th, and that would follow in line, so we'd have the budget hearings and the adoption of the budget at your regular meeting and your work session in August.
Can you have the department heads present, so if we have any questions?
We will.
Thank you.
Public Works, you can, do you have anything else?
If you want to take on things, we can go sidewalks pretty well done, except for some vegetation coming back there. Next week, we expect the big crosswalk sidewalk to get started there at the middle school. It's been a long time coming.
Make sure we're in the crosswalk.
Let's see what else. Streetscapes is still, you know, the last little details are still coming in. We have good weather tomorrow. We're supposed to get a lot of paint on the streets for things like ADA spaces, motorcycle spaces, loading zones, things like that. You guys are going to move forward with a lot of signage, so you see a lot of signs moving around in the next couple of weeks. Electricity, we've still got a little electrical work going on there. And maybe just, if you notice, there's some couple places where the stripes don't look like they're quite finished yet. So we've got a little bit of that. But hopefully we'll see some changes tomorrow, especially towards the end of the day. Well, the picnic area is part due next Wednesday.
Pardon?
Next Wednesday. Picnic area.
With the middle part?
Picnic here.
Yes. All right, gotcha. Thank you. Who's the part that
we can approve the GP?
Yeah. I don't see Mr. Gerard here, but order appears to be in good shape. Comments? Mr. City Manager?
Mr. Gerard, I believe, is on vacation, but I confirm that. On the streetscape, 4th of July is coming up on Wednesday, and we have the city responsible for the day's events. Those are available on a couple different websites. There's a 4th of July honor page, originally created by the chamber and maintained by that. Chamber is a sponsor for the fireworks event at the end of the day. Everyone's invited and should have a good time. Thank you.
Mr. City Attorney?
I have one question to ask, and
asking to sell it to the state of Georgia. During the survey process of that, the surveyors identified a couple of two or three very minor encroachments on the city right-of-way. One parking space, part of one sign, another sign, flagpole. It in no way impedes the use of the right-of-way, but it does have a legal consequence. And what we're being asked to do is to allow those encroachments to remain of their very normal. The city could, at any time if it wished, revoke that license to keep those encroachments in place. But most likely you would never do that. And they're for that sale to go through, we're being asked to execute some form of a document or letter that would allow those encroachments to remain. And they're extremely normal. I could show you the document. The sale is going to occur on August 2nd. So, and this just came up on Friday, so I'm at a point now where I'm having to ask you to allow staff or the manager to execute such a document in the meantime so that the sale can move forward.
Any understanding, memorandum of understanding we have with the regions, we need to really make sure we keep up with that because they have amnesia after a few years with some of our agreements out.
Well, of course, it's the on August 2nd, the sale will occur to Northeast Georgia. On August 3rd, the sale will occur from Northeast Georgia to the state. And so the entity that's seeking to allow these encroachments to continue is the state. That's
the Board of Regents or the state? The
Board of Regents.
Okay, I'd like to review on the side of the group prepare and we'll look at it.
Could we get a motion of some sort on that?
I believe that you'd, okay.
I'll make a motion that we proceed with a letter of what memorandum of understanding, is that the correct term?
Some
form of document that will be reviewed by the mayor and can be signed by staff.
That's a motion, is there a second? And on our discussion, I'd like for you to put on our website just so that it's public information and it's clear and public for review.
I can deliver to you tomorrow a highlighted plat that Bill could put on the website.
Just put on the city website so that
you can see those three transparent spots.
So, with that motion, are we authorizing Mr. Mayor
to execute? The memorandum of understanding?
Yeah, I think so.
I would like that ability. That would be
good. Do I need to amend my motion?
Okay.
I mean, if that's what it is, I'm not going to vote for it because a memo of understanding should be voted by the body.
Okay.
That's my opinion.
All right. So before the council is a memorandum of understanding that we will allow the continued encroachment on the city right-of-way.
Yes. And the government can object one thing. It's an encroachment agreement, basically what it is. And they're extremely common and likely. So I don't think it's an extraordinary request that they're making. Yet it's a memorandum of understanding may elevate it too highly to put it in. Because it's part of one parking space and then a flagpole and a couple of things like that. It's not really as grand a document as an MOU would be. It's basically a relatively common encroachment agreement.
Okay, so we don't need a memorandum of understanding, we need an encroachment agreement.
Yeah, that would be what it would be. Well, that would be the normal nomenclature that you would apply to that type of agreement.
say that we should prepare an encroachment agreement to be reviewed and signed by the mayor or staff, whoever they decide.
A motion, is there a second?
Second.
A motion and a second. And I'll reiterate that I would like that document to be placed on our city website or the public to be able to view and access. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, very good.
Thank you very much. I didn't mean to overly dramatize that. Thank you.
Mayor comments, no city council comments. Ms. Hill, do you have
any? Yes, I have several comments. First of all, I want to thank Mark and the Public Works. I think our downtown is beautiful with all the flowers and the barrels. I love the way you stagger them in height. It just looks very good. I don't think I've seen downtown look any better.
That's Mike and Melody and Donna. So
Mike and Melody and Donna, okay.
Great job at doing that.
It really, really does look good, and I'd like to commend the staff for that. Also, I'd like to commend them for doing all of the research you had to do to get the playground together, and I really appreciate that because I think this is going to be something that we will be proud of. And the other thing, I just wanted to give you a quick report. We had our Southeast Tourism Society Marketing College last week, and we had 300 tourism professionals from 13 states here for the week. And they really enjoyed their meeting like they normally do. And they were, again, very complimentary of the Gold Museum. They had a chance to go through it, and they were really excited about the way it looks now. And they would not have been able to come to Dahlonega if UNG had not helped by letting them use their meeting space and to hold their meetings in. And I know there's no one from UNG here, but I would like to recognize the fact that each year they do this, and they've done the same for the last 25 years. So thank you for letting the Marketing College come. It's really helped, I think, all of us and given us new ideas.
Just a quick question for Dan. I know we list properties on the DDA website or available space on the DDA website. Are we doing any other ongoing marketing efforts to highlight those vacancies, and are we have a list of businesses that we contact and say, can we? I know at one time there was one.
Yeah, I mean, we are, there is a database that has any people who have been interested, and we do go back and contact those. We're also fielding any calls that happen to come in. Short of that, and again, putting things on the website, I suppose that we would do things as far as putting out, and I think our Facebook gets a wonderful reach and to note, I guess, highlight that please come to that site.
Yeah, I know.
Maybe people don't know to go to the website. And if you know the website, both cities and the Main Street DDAs are really revamped. And so there could be ways that could hopefully drive more people to delve into the pages that we have in the businesses that are buildings that are ready.
Okay, thanks.
As a follow up to that, Jen, are you aware of what the vacancy rate is on the square?
I can pull that pretty quickly because I just have to count the number of properties.
Okay.
And I can get that to you and add that to you.
There's no vacancy. Thank you. That's all right.
Okay, I can get that to you.
Just a quick question for Jen.
Thank you.
Where are concerts?
afraid of is that the holidays are maybe hitting.
We're not going to be involved in any discussion on how she's going to do that, right? This is all up to the city manager and you?
DDA.
DDA?
We. As in you, will not be involved.
Okay.
We, as in me, will be involved.
I think I understood that. The only reason I brought that up is that, and I said that out when I went to a festival in Brazosville, and they allowed a restaurant to be able to do that. Something that we might think about in the future, that if a restaurant wants to do that, or we alternate it, or whatever else, but that would be a DDA discussion if they wanted to get involved in that. But I thought that was pretty clean on how they did it. I don't know if you had a contact there or not, or how they rotate the mat, or whatever. That's all I have.
Of course, I'm over the suggestion that I think that it might be useful.
I would check the Brazosville just to see how they did it at a street festival when they allow a restaurant. And I don't know if they rotated the restaurants or how they do it.
If DDA owns that license, though, it doesn't necessarily have to be in Hancock Park.
The model that, you know, from our retreat over Madison has kind of sparked this discussion. Madison's got a great process for the DDA. I can actually sell some park and use it as a fundraiser for revenue.
Because during the criteria would be another opportunity, which that wouldn't take place in Hancock Park, but it might be somewhere on the sidewalks.
I would just like to compliment and thank the staff, second what Helen said with regards to the playground. I think that's going to be really exciting. And one of the things that unfortunately in government seems to happen is things move very slowly. And I think when we approved this a month or so ago, we set an objective or a goal to try to have this completed and operational by the summer of 2019. So I hope that that's still possible as you got your approval to move forward tonight. That we can make that an objective at the latest, perhaps. That's all I can think.
Movies at night, the second Friday movies, it's something that they come to us and I guess we take it to you and take you.
Are we advertising that this is something that we're going to start doing?
As far as food, like food truck ride or something?
Well, I'm talking about food trucks with the music in the park or, you know, whether it be the market or the movies under the stars. I mean, how does anybody know that
they're doing it? Actively soliciting, because a lot of times those have been the events that are being run by other
outside. Don't we want to allow, to tell people that we are allowing this so that we can have an interest? Because if you don't tell anybody, nobody knows.
And that could, again, that could be a section as far as getting it out to the world. That it could be at the DDA website.com, that kind of thing. I probably have a list of food trucks. I can try to start gathering more to again have a database project out to them.
Yeah, I mean, it's just something we wanted to do, and I don't see us getting any traction on that.
Okay.
I don't know. I'll ask another question.
Very good. I would just like to reiterate what Rob had to say earlier. It relates to the chamber. The chamber and the DDA is very active, as y'all can tell. They've got a lot going on.
everything is written and ready, it's just got to be uploaded to that. I would like to have a park rules, but once that is on the website, then I can unleash my letter to George Main Street and the other avenues. I think some other folks have been giving me other avenues that I can send out to, rather than just the channel of having it on the website. Yeah, and
I forwarded to you a possible intern.
Yes, you did. I had to follow up with that. And we've got another inquiry that I have sent something to, but I know there are some wonderful candidates out there, and I can look forward to a very difficult decision.
Okay, sir. Do you have comments from council or staff?
I'll offer you one that you're aware of. You're familiar with that interns in the past, successfully through the UNG. We're going to be trying to start a new program for students that qualify for